Hey, Angel here for mynexttablet.com, today with an unboxing of the new Lenovo IdeaPad D330, a new and very interesting Windows tablet. Alright, let's start the unboxing of the Lenovo IdeaPad D330. This one is a 10.1-inch Windows tablet with a detachable keyboard dock. And yeah, this is a successor to the Lenovo Mix 320 that was introduced almost 2 years ago, just over maybe 1.5 years ago. And yeah, with 10.1 inches, it is also a direct competitor to the Microsoft Surface Go, which I reviewed already if you want to check out the video on this channel. So today we want to unbox the Lenovo IdeaPad D330. I will quickly put it to the side here and then let's see what else is inside the box. This is the tablet itself. Then we've got some quick start guide and warranty stuff and so on. Nothing too special. And inside here, let's see what we have. We've got this power plug here. Yes, that's certainly it. And it is a USB-C connector, which is certainly nice to see that it is charged using USB Type-C. And then down here, we've got the keyboard cover, which, by the way, is included out of the box. So you don't have to buy it separately, unlike with the Microsoft Surface Go, where you have to spend another $100, depending on the country. So that's the keyboard. Let's quickly put it down there, because we want to take a look at the tablet first. So this is a 10.1 inch display. We've got a 2-megapixel front-facing camera over there, 2 speakers on the bottom here, and all the way on the bottom we've got the connector for the keyboard cover or the keyboard dock, and then we've got a microSD card slot and in this case also a SIM card slot over here because I've got the LTE version. Then we've got a connector for the power plug, however you can also charge it over USB-C. This is a USB-C 3.1 port. Then we've got a volume rocker over here, power button on the top, nothing. And on this side, we've got a headphone jack, which is nice to see as well. On the back, we've got another 5-megapixel camera. And yeah, this is a full plastic body, which you can expect at the price. The price is starting at 299 euros. That's the cheapest version. You can also get it for 449 euros and for 499 euros, so roughly 500 euros, and that is the one that I have. Right now, I don't know any US prices yet because I believe it is not announced for the United States yet. However, the prices should be relatively similar. All versions are cheaper than the Microsoft Surface Go with a keyboard in Germany. And yeah, the relation between those should be similar in the United States as well. So it will probably cost between 249 and maybe 449 US dollars. That's what I'm guessing. All right, that is the tablet itself. Let's take a look at the keyboard cover. Obviously, this is a pretty standard chiclet style keyboard. However, because of the 10-inch screen, it is just a bit smaller than your standard keyboard. I like that we have separated arrow keys here, so you could use this for some games as well if you like. And yeah, it's a bit smaller, so usually we have to get used to it just a bit. Then we've got a relatively big touchpad underneath the keyboard, and on both sides we've got USB type A but USB 2.0 ports on both sides. So you've got one type C 3.1 and two type A USB 2.0 ports. So quite some ports here, that's certainly nice. And the keyboard here is made out of plastic as well, and it's connected this way. I will quickly show you. And yeah, just a standard keyboard dock as we are used to from a lot of tablets in the past, right? But not recently. This is one of the few newer ones that have this kind of keyboard dock. All right, let's turn it on and check out the hardware and so on a bit in more detail. All right, I'm back. I connected the Lenovo IdeaPad D330 to my Wi-Fi and I already set it up. And yeah, now we can take a closer look at it. And let's start with the display, which is a 10.1-inch display, and you can get two versions of it. The cheapest one for 299 euros has an HD resolution with 1280 by 800. The other two versions have a full HD display, that's the one I have, with 1920 by 1200. And I always think that a full HD resolution on 10 inches is totally fine. Obviously, if you hold it very closely to your eyes, then you will see some pixels that it doesn't look super sharp, but if you have it normally in front of you, then everything like text and icons, they look totally fine and sharp. I also like that this screen is laminated, so there's no air gap between the touchscreen and the IPS panel, and that is certainly nice to see here. And overall, the display has pretty good. Everything seems to be fine here. And the brightness is totally fine. I don't even have it to maximum. I have it to 50%. You can make it a bit brighter. I don't think it will be that readable in direct sunlight, but for everything else, the brightness is totally fine. Colors look fine as well, and the viewing angles are pretty good. It's an IPS panel, so nothing special, but totally fine. So especially the full HD version here, I've got nothing bad to say about the display so far. And then we can take a look inside the tablet, kind of at least. You can get two versions again. One comes with an Intel N4000 processor, and the other one with an N5000 chipset. Both are Intel Gemini-like chipset, so the successor to the Apollo-like generation that we've seen last year. And the cheapest version comes with an Intel N4000 Celeron processor, and that is a dual-core chip with two cores clocked at 1.1 GHz, and they can go up to 2.6 GHz in turbo boost, and with that one you also get 2 GB of RAM. And the N4000 is the successor to the N3350. Maybe you've seen a device with that in the past. There were a couple of notebooks and convertibles released with that one. And the two more expensive versions, one of them I've got here, both feature the Intel Pentium Silver N5000 chipset. That's the one I've got here. And that is a quad-core chip with four cores clocked at 1.1 GHz. And they can go up to 2.7 GHz in turbo boost. And that is the successor to the N4200 chipset that we've seen in the Acer Switch 3, for example, but also the TrackStore PrimeTap T13B, if you're in Europe, and that one has the same chipset as the Acer Switch 3. And the Microsoft Surface Go, just as a comparison, has an Intel Pentium Gold 4415Y chipset. That one is a dual-core chip again. And I already did some benchmarks. Oh, by the way, the other two more expensive versions have 4 GB of RAM. So this one has 4 GB of RAM as well. I'm quickly connecting it to the keyboard dock so I can just go a bit quicker into my folders here. You can get, again, three versions with the storage. There are really a lot of versions here. You can get it with 32 GB, 64 GB, and 128 GB. And I've got the 128 GB version. And with that one out of the box, you can still use 95.8 GB by yourself. So the 128 GB should certainly be enough. And the 64 GB should be fine too for most, unless you need to store a lot of files locally. The 32 GB version is obviously a bit small for Windows. You won't have that much left. I already ran Geekbench 4, and I will run it again for the final review, because there's McAfee popping up here and there might be updates downloading in the background. But a first benchmark test here from Geekbench 4, and the single core test just over 2000 points, and it's a multi-core test over 5,900 points. And that is quite interesting, because in the single core test, it is just below the Surface Go, really not much below, but just very little below. And in the multi-core test, it is faster than the Surface Go, because as I said, the Surface Go is a dual core chip, while this one is quad core, so the multi-core score should be higher. So the performance here with 4 GB of RAM certainly should be fine for office work, especially for browsing the web, writing Microsoft Word, It should be fine for some light Photoshop work. Don't expect too much, but simple things you should be able to do just fine in Photoshop. And in theory, you could also edit full HD videos on here using video editing apps like Cyberlink PowerDirector, for example. Usually that one runs fine on devices like these. What did I do so far? I just browsed the web and Edge a bit. And we can just start a YouTube video just for fun, but obviously that totally should work on here. Browsing the web, working in Office apps, that all should be fine on here. Reading some PDFs and so on. And there we've got a YouTube video running in HD. We can switch to full screen here. And that should run fine. I just wanted to quickly show that. Let's quickly get out of that. There we go. Netflix should run fine on here. You can also use the Netflix app from the Microsoft Store if you like. So the performance should be fine for a simple thing. Certainly, in theory, you might be able to run Fortnite on here and it might be playable at around 20 frames per second to 30 frames most of the time. However, with the Surface Go, I saw some heavy stuttering in between, and I think that will be the case here too. So I don't think it is really usable for Fortnite that much. Let's quickly take a look at the keyboard cover again. I typed on here a little bit already, and yeah, it's totally fine. Maybe you have to get used to it for 1 or 2 days or something, but then it should be fine. I was able to type on here blindly without any issues. The touchpad seems to work just fine as well. And by the way, that is the widest angle you can open it with the keyboard attached. However, if you want to put it separately, then you can. So you can put it like this. That is always quite useful. For example, if you're in an airplane or in a train or something, at least if you're in economy class, you don't have that much room on the table, right? And you can just put it further back like this, the screen, and then it's easier to see something, to watch a movie or so. So that's certainly nice. You can also just put it in this tent mode if you want. Lenovo is always advertising that. What else do I have to say about this? Not much yet. The build quality, obviously, I said it earlier, is not as high-end as with the Microsoft Surface Go, but it also is a lot cheaper than the Microsoft Surface Go. At least in Europe, the highest-end version of this, including LTE, including 128 GB, with 4 GB of RAM and the N5000 chipset, is cheaper than the cheapest Surface Go with a keyboard. And then the Surface Go does not have LTE, and that one has only 64 GB of storage. So yeah, even the highest end version of this is a bit cheaper than the Surface Go. Again, I think prices should be, at least the relationship of the prices should be similar in the United States, but it is not out in the United States yet, but in Europe it certainly is slowly available. Alright, my first impressions are pretty good. The main reason is, as I said, it almost has no competitors, and the only one from a more famous brand is more expensive. You can get the Shubi Surfbook Mini, which is a China tablet, and that one is quite interesting actually. It will be a bit slower. That one has the N3450, and yeah, it's a bit slower. Has a full HD resolution too though, and yeah, a nice metal body. However, with that one you obviously don't get the same warranties and so on that Lenovo is offering. Otherwise, really quite interesting. If you have any questions about it, please write me in the comments and maybe I can test something specific that you might be requesting. And yeah, I will start my review of the IdeaPad D730 now. I'm ANJ for MyNextTablet.com, and this is the Lenovo IdeaPad D730, a new affordable 10-inch Windows tablet. Thanks for watching.